And now you are tuned in to Valley Views with your host Hector and co-host Carlos.
Yo, it's Fernando. Shouts out to Valley Views, man. They played me on the station. I was like, let me make you a jingle. So this is my jingle I made for them.
This is what I had to do. This is Valley View. This is what I had to do. This is Valley View. Come and sing it like, hey, hey.
I wasn't tripping when I lost my job. No reason to lie to my mom. Now I've got 8, 9 to 5, y'all. I was like, right on, right on, right on. No work on weekends, eh? Waking up early, sleep at 8. I think I'm surely dreaming, eh? Just look at what Burns achieving, eh? Tony Pro skater, I'm gonna grind. Not one opportunity I will decline. I show up early like people time. Jokes and truth, I jot in the rhyme. Chicano house, 2 Omatsu now. To a song with y'all in his papa's house. 8182 San Diego. Become a legend in the valley like Danny Trejo.
This is what I had to do. This is Valley View. This is what I had to do. This is Valley View. Come and sing it like, hey, hey.
Yes, yes. That's right, folks. We are back right here. Valley Views, y'all. Big shout out to Fernando Pay. You're listening to Fernando Pay right there. That was a custom Valley Views theme that he did for us. A big shout out to him. Also on that intro track, you heard Saint Sergi, hip hop artist. What up, Saint Sergi? Hope you're doing well in the whole Why Not Rave crew. And we're back right here, both myself, Hector, just an honor to be here on this lovely Sunday, along with Carlos. Carlos, how you doing? That's my co-host right there.
I'm doing good.
I don't even know if I should call you intern anymore. I think I'm going to just call you co-host.
Call me co-host at this point.
You know, I like that better. But anyway, how are you, Carlos?
I'm doing good. I mean, like Super Bowl weekend, I'm super excited for it, even though I'm not even like a football fan or anything. It's just the commercials for me.
You know what I mean? That's what does it for you. Yeah, for everybody does something different, right?
Except for you,
the commercials.
I mean, it's weird though, because like a lot of people are rooting for the Bengals for like a lot of like weird like reasons. Like that whole Simpsons thing, did you hear about that?
No, tell me.
It was like people found like a picture from way back when about the Simpsons being like, yo, like
they always find pictures of the Simpsons like that, right?
And so like, they have one of the Bengals. They predicted like the Bengals are gonna win or something, but like people also found out that the picture was photoshopped. Whole thing from there.
Yeah, those Simpsons are they're relevant. You know, they're still relevant. I still remember when I had I think I might have shown you when I back in the classroom, but I have these that my wife and I believe brother-in-law gave me these old VHS tapes, and it was like a little series of the Simpsons, you know, like episode whatever it was, you know, and but it was on VHS. But that's just I'm just dating myself right now, how old I am, you know. But then again, I teach history and I lived through all of it, so you can only imagine how old I am. But you know, I gotta say, it's just great to be here. It's a great energy. Not only is it, you know, like again a super Sunday because of the game, but also more importantly, I think here on Valley Views, you know, we just wrapped up an interview with Alexis Romo. Yeah. And then we get the pleasure, y'all, of having another Romo, but this is the one and only, everybody, Noemi Romo in the house. Noemi, how are you? Good morning.
Hello. I'm good. I'm grateful to be here. Side note, Raider Nation. Shout out to my brother, Rambo.
Well, hey, I'm Raider Nation too. So see, hey. I'm already... Okay, now I'm going to let you off easier, all right? Because of that. I just have pure easy questions for you then, you know? We're not going to get all crazy. No, but that's awesome. I love that. You know, it's... I was not expecting Raider Nation in this conversation, but I'm glad it came out.
True.
I mean, at this point, it's definitely, you know, there's always next season, and that's been the case for many seasons, but it's all good.
We're still committed to excellence. We broke the record. Right? We're here.
We made it in the playoffs, you know? Yes. But, you know, I gotta tell you, though, and, you know, I watch football and all that, but, you know, I also am, you know, aware of, you know, some of the... you know, racist remarks that have been made, like, you know, in the NFL, including our very own, you know, Chucky and others. You know, I acknowledge some of the things that also the NFL, you know, caused, like, in our communities, you know, like, in in that sense, I'm talking about Inglewood, because I know folks that actually lived there. Like, and you know, so I also do want to just acknowledge that too, some of the impact of gentrification and how it is a real deal too. You know, I mean, I luckily got a special opportunity to go and, you know, I was able to do like a private tour of SoFi Stadium and all that. And it was great being there, of course. I just seen the, because I also know folks that are unionized and as electricians and like construction workers that help build that stadium, you know. Mm-hmm. So I you know, I see like the impact on different levels, right? One of the actual jobs that were created during that time, many of which my compadre John and other folks I know that worked there physically, like to help make that stadium happen, right? And so I see the economic impact of that, but also you had the other economic impact, of course, of what's going on in that community too. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, there's just the impact of the game, and like there's a lot of layers there, you know.
Definitely.
And but at the same time, it's just so dope that halftime, you know, primarily an all black lineup, you know, except for Eminem, but it's all good, you know. Eminem, we show love to Eminem too, but you know what I mean, like we got Snoop Dogg, we got Kendrick, we have Dr. Dre, Mary J. Blige, come on now, you know. So it's kind of like, so it's like, you know, it's a lot of layers to today as far as that goes too, you know.
True.
But anyway, with that said, Raider Nation. But yeah, just tell us. I mean, so one of the things that we you know, love to do here is just start with a little grounding and like, yeah, how's right now in this space right here with us, your mind, body, and spirit?
My emotional self is good. My physical self is feeling a little sore from hiking with my mom the other day, but other than that, good. And I feel like both parts are tending well to my spirit. So all in all, I'm really just grateful to be here.
Beautiful, beautiful. Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing that. And it's good to get to hear like where people are, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I think yeah, myself, I mean, I'm pretty I definitely been a little exhausted physically, so I'm just trying to take care of the physical.
Mm-hmm.
Along with the mental, there's been so much, and trying to like consume a lot and then trying to like filter things, and so you know, on that level, I'm feeling a lot better, like more clear-headed. And then, yeah, just spiritually, just trying to continue to stay grounded. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just that's just helps the other two pieces too as well, you know? Most and Carlos, definitely. What about yourself? Like, yeah, just how's your mind, body, spirit right here, right now?
Mind, body, and spirit right now, I'm going to have to say, mentally, I'm on autopilot right now. Just with like a lot of homework and stuff.
Yeah.
Physically, I feel like I could run a mile right now. Like I'm energetic.
Nice.
And spirit, spiritually, like I feel like really good, like real like at home right now. You know what I mean?
Okay. Yes. Uh-huh. Yes. Yeah. Love it. I love it. And then so you know, one of the things that as we're talking about this, I was just thinking about it too, like connecting things. And you know, obviously we just had your sister-in-law right on the show. Mm-hmm. And it's you know, it's interesting because a lot of stuff that she talked about is very similar to the stuff that you're really passionate about, Noemi, too.
Yeah.
You know, and but before we get into some of those passions, just tell us a little bit about yeah, just yourself here, your connection just first to the Valley, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about that. Yeah.
Well, born and raised here. I was born in Sylmar.
Yeah.
Sylmar.
I was born in Sylmar, grew up in like the Van Nuys, Panorama City area my whole life. And when I was about 10, I actually moved to Mexico with my mom so that she could get amnistía. Amnesty for those who don't speak Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
And while I was living out there, I really saw the difference between living in an urban environment and living in a ranch.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Oh.
Like the culture shock right there.
Total culture shock.
Because 10 years in, you could already kind of, you got used to a certain lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go over there, it's like...
Yeah,
a little different.
Very different. Just like seeing how much weather impacted the day to day for one thing. Like there was this one month where it was raining relentlessly, and I lost so many shoes in the road. I had to walk barefoot in the mud for like a couple weeks. But just like the diversity of animals and plants out there versus here, you know, like here, I'm like, oh my God, that's a ladybug. And over there, it's like, what is that bug? I don't even know.
Can it eat?
can't eat me. That exactly.
Is it venomous? Is it poisonous?
Dude, yeah. I saw my mom grab a rattlesnake by the end of the tail and just like lasso it away.
So, they're like, how did you do that?
I'm like, and there was no opportunity joke, for her to show me that out here, you know? But yeah, so when I came back, that was something that really stuck with me, was like having to fight for, or that I had to actively work at being connected to nature. Mm. As Lexi touched earlier in the segment, you know, it's concrete. It's a concrete jungle out here.
Yeah, it really is.
If you live in the heart of the valley and you want to get connected to nature, you got to get in a little car and drive out to Angeles Forest. I know so many people who, instead of going to the parks that are local to us, go to like Lake Balboa. Mm. They go to El Melvany, and like, I'm not saying that's bad. It's just, why do you have to waste gas money?
That's true.
Why do you have to waste an hour or so on the bus? Like, that's that's where we have room to improve, I guess, is what I'm getting at.
Straight up. And you know, yeah. And I think, like, you know, when we're talking before today's show, it's like, yeah, you know, you got me thinking on things like that too, you know, just like how some of us, you know, it's more accessible to some of us than others, depending on our resources. You know, of course, like for some of us, even just having like that privilege to be able to get into a car and have the time to go somewhere like that, you know, like go on hikes.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it should be really, you know, accessible to all, right? Nature and green space, really. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we know that there's other communities around the world that, you know, create green space. So it's kind of one of those things where just being able to envision that in our community here, you know, the San Fernando Valley, is also just kind of key to the well-being of all of us, you know, and to our like mental health, you know, because, again, like even just thinking about the mind, body, and spirit, you know, those all three things like really do need sometimes that connect, and the, I guess, like the time and space to actually be in nature, to actually sometimes get all your stuff right and like your balance of all three things, you know, because like concrete jungles could get to all of us very quickly, you know.
Absolutely. And I feel a huge difference both physically and mentally when I'm not getting my hands in the soil versus when I am. And I really feel that's something that unfortunately a lot of us have been disconnected to, not just because of outside factors for the most part, like the fact that it isn't so easily accessible. Like I believe it was you, Carlos, who mentioned like some people don't even have yards.
Like
then you have to like put up money for like a pot and a plant, and you have to really like fight just to get your hands in the soil.
Isn't that like, what an injustice, right? Like, you have to even fight for just that, you know?
True.
Or green space, you know? Instead, we get, unfortunately, sadly, brownfields in our communities, you know? So you grew up here in the Valley, and you went to Mexico, and you, you know, pretty much experienced a completely different lifestyle. I mean, come on now. Having your mom dance, fight, I don't know what she was doing with that rattlesnake, you know?
Yeah.
A little different than what might be happening out in Panorama City, you know?
Hugely different. And yeah, like going from seeing like this lush area to like just all of these plots of empty, unused lands basically being used for garbage, that has an impact on everybody that lives nearby those spaces. And you see it a lot in the heart of the valley. So it's like the Panorama City, Van Nuys, North Hills, Pacoima area. Like, so one of the things that I'm involved is the Panorama City Rock Garden, which was started by, shout out, Javier Mendoza.
Yes.
Shout out.
Which, by the way, Javier, well, let's just say I think his view of the game is going to be a little different than most of ours, you know? I got a message from him, and anyway, he was like, guess where I'll be on Sunday. He's not going to be in front of the TV watching it.
No.
Put it that way. But anyway, I'll leave it at that.
Yeah. So yeah, basically, Javier, he was tired of seeing this little piece of land in his area being used for trash. So, you know, he cleaned it up. Sure enough, within the week, more trash, a whole couch, like garbage. So he's like, all right, well, what can I do here? So he removed the garbage and started putting plants down. Mm-hmm. And very quickly, people just started getting involved. It started becoming a garden. And then more than that, it became into an art space because, you know, it started during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. Everybody was, you know, going through it at many levels. But yeah, everybody...
That's true.
Was going oh, through yeah. it.
That was tough times right there.
Tough
you know?
Times. God, yeah. So much uncertainty and you really had to fight for hope. And I think that's what the Panorama City Rock Garden did was it not only gave people hope, mm. it gave people a space to give others messages of hope. Mm. And that was what was so beautiful about it was like, you know, I'd be walking along and seeing like a little rock saying, "You are enough." And I'm like, oh my God, I am.
Thank you so much.
You just changed my life, Rock. But for real though, like it was.
Who would have thought, right? A rock would do that for you, you know?
Rock with a little Sharpie on it.
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, and some people even paint beautiful portraits and leave it there. And it's just really, it was really incredible that like during just such a traumatizing time that mm-hmm. people nobody knows who painted these rocks. We don't know if they're kids, we don't know if they're full-grown adults, we don't know if they're seniors, but the fact that people would mindfully make these pieces of art and put them in the garden for others to see
just because they wanted to
that's beautiful. And for me, that it honestly changed my life and my trajectory. Thank you, Javier. Thank you, Jonathan, for putting it on Instagram, which is how I found it. It's really beautiful what that garden did for a lot of people.
Yeah, and I guess what it continues to do in that sense, you know? Mm-hmm. So you get uplifted by a rock. And then, but in a way, right? But it's, but in a way, if you think about it, it's not really, it's the rock is just kind of like the... almost like a way of like
to push people
pushing, but also more than like connecting, you know, rocks mm-hmm. are just connecting one person to another person, you know,
and
connecting it to like Mother Earth in that way too, you know, mm-hmm. and connecting it to nature and connecting it to humanity too, you know, mm-hmm. And so, you know, now that you're kind of back over here in the U.S., you come back from Mexico and all that, and, you know, you start seeing these spaces like Panorama Rock Garden, where did you kind of then start to get that inclination to, you know what I mean, like push yourself mm-hmm. to like next levels as far as like how you are going to interact with nature in your community out here in the Valley?
Yeah, so just to give a little background, I've been more or less involved in the plant sciences for like almost a decade now. Mm-hmm. When I was studying as an undergraduate at Cal State LA, and I was working in the plant sciences through biochemistry, but there was just always something missing. There was always something missing. It was like, I have no other way of describing other than it was very cold to me.
Okay. Mm.
So, you know, the pandemic happens, I take a step back and like go through my own, like what everybody did, which was like, what am I doing with my life?
Yep,
and as I was reflecting on my own life and my recent experiences with academia and moving back home too, like I had just moved back from the city during the pandemic. So I'm suddenly faced with like, oh, wow, like my community is suffering. Yeah. Like there's really no green spaces nearby for people to enjoy during this pandemic. The places that are available, unfortunately, riddled with like, you know, like homeless encampments and just unfortunately drugs and violence. Mm-hmm. I really couldn't escape the fact that like the green spaces that were easily accessible to us were not the most safe. So then I got out my binoculars and started like bird watching. Mm-hmm. I found the Panorama City Rock Garden through Instagram and like went out for a volunteer day. And, you know, we're like collecting all this garbage from like literally a foot into the ground. Like we're finding all these like things. And, you know, I suddenly was just like, you know what? Like we already started on this plot of land. We can do more. Like there's so many spaces here that need that. So I went over to the other side of that piece of land, and I pretty much started tending to the soil and Sowed some wildflower seeds, started putting plants, and specifically California native plants. Because my passion is about restoration. It's about helping all of the animals and insects and plants that are currently endangered because of climate change, because of invasive species. That's what I'm about. I want to restore as many spaces as I can to help support those species that are currently in danger.
And so, and it sounds like, tell us, I'm just curious. So, I mean, there's like here, there are such, like, what are some of those, like, you know, endangered species that we have, you know?
So, so actually the monarch butterfly, it's not on the endangered species list because unfortunately it was, it qualifies, but it's too low on the list of priorities to officially be an endangered species.
Got it.
That's where we're at
like
right
politics,
now.
That's like politics, you know, that's where the politics kick in, you know?
Exactly.
Even with nature, there's always politics, you know?
And that was some of the news in 2020 that, that I read and a lot of people in my community, my California native plant community read, and we were like, oh, the world is burning, the skies are orange, the monarchs.
I guess because the monarchs don't have a powerful lobbyist, you know?
Hire them.
You know, they're too busy flying, you know, and migrating north and south, you know?
So with that, you know, I'm like, okay, the monarchs are endangered. I'm going to sow some narrow leaf milkweed. And milkweed is just it's the plants that the butterflies lay their eggs on in order for the caterpillars to grow and eat up. So I put down some narrow leaf milkweed in the rock garden, and, you know, haven't had any monarchs yet, but when those are bigger, that will be a space for them to land. And I've seen monarchs in that area. Yeah. And then with the wildflower seeds, it was this like butterfly mix from the Theodore Payne Foundation. It has California native wildflowers. I put them down, they grew, and what do you know, I'm suddenly seeing many species of bees, not just the European honeybee, not just that one. I'm seeing sweat bees, I'm seeing like they're tiny little things, tiny little bees, and I'm trying to figure out what they all are. And
that's awesome.
Yeah,
like, almost like, so you're like in a way like trying to document them too then.
Definitely trying to document them. And just, and it, what blew me away was, I mean, for the folks at home listening, like, you can't see what I'm doing with my arms right now.
Actually,
but like,
we're on YouTube too, so
this much,
nice,
this little parcel of land, wildflowers, suddenly I'm seeing a ton of bees that are native to California, like all of a sudden. And that's the beautiful thing about it, is that when you put, if you put those plants that they need down, they will find it because they are in need of it.
Wow.
There are so many species of plants that people bring from other countries. Understandably, you always want to bring a piece of home with you.
Right,
you know,
right.
I get that.
Yep.
But it's kind of degrading our landscape, unfortunately. So that's why it's important to try to put down plants that are actually native to your area.
Have a little green on you.
Have a little green on you. Yeah. And just give a home. Give a home to a species, pretty much. Yep, they will come. They will come.
I don't know if Carlos over here is talking about Dr. Dre or like the, like, you know, but anyway, have a little, sorry, I'm thinking
Super Bowl.
I'm just thinking a Super Bowl hat. I've been rocking like Dr. Dre a lot, but anyway, no, but you know, but you know, I gotta tell you though, Noemi, like what you just said right now, I'm just tripping out because this whole idea of like sometimes if there's just a little space and then you start to create something there, like how you could literally kind of like start that ecosystem up that's native, you know?
Exactly.
And it's like, how does it make you feel though? Like to actually like that you did that and then you had like these native bees come to pretty much pollinate. Like, I mean, how was that experience? Like just to actually see it and watch like nature at work in that way. And like you kind of were a little bit of that like catalyst, you know, for it.
I'm not going to lie. I teared up. Like I can't tell you, I can't imagine I'm the only person who feels this way. There's no way that I'm the only person that, like, every time you get some headline about something going endangered or today's the hottest day on record, which is like every
year. Oh my God, yeah, we were talking about that.
It impacts you.
It's scary.
Yeah, it's really scary. And you're just like, okay, is this the end? So to see just that little bit of hope manifested in a little bee, it, you know, it really moved me. It really moved me, and it was always just a reminder, like, okay, I'm living in a meaningful present.
Yeah.
I'm doing something right now that is helping this little animal right now.
Wow.
And that I hope nobody underestimates the power of that, because it for me it was huge. And yeah, I'm really grateful that I have the Panorama City Rock Garden as a learning ground, as an outlet, definitely as an outlet, as a learning ground, as an opportunity to just try my hand at this and really do it.
It sounds like that was one place. I mean, you already had it in you, but that really was like a hub to kind of like start making those connections, and then from there kind of expanding out, but still coming back to that hub, that center, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And more than that, it kind of became an art space too. We started having events like the Earth Day event, because shout out to Liz, her and her dad made a little library and put it at the Rock Garden. It's so cute. And nice. You know, so it all of a sudden has this educational aspect to it. There's many books there from like wildlife of California to tips from dog trainers, how to train your man. I'm not kidding you. Wow. Somebody left that. Tips from dog trainers, how to train your man.
Oh,
the title was something like that. Okay. Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess some of those dudes that are dogs need a little dog training, you know? Ooh, okay.
That's crazy.
Like, who's a good boy? Here's a treat. Good boy.
We had a good laugh over that one. Wow. But just to show, like, the range of things that are, like, showing up that. Yeah. We've also had, like, poetry events there with Drifter Zine, which was started by Maddie and Ivan. And yeah, it's just really grown into something beyond just a garden. It's an art space, it's a community space, and it's beautiful.
Nice. And like, just hearing this, Carlos, like knowing that, like, how does that make you feel? You know,
I mean, I feel like it's really good in the sense that like everyone has an outlet at the end of the day. You know what I mean? Like, regardless if it's like doing little things as hobbies or just like joining clubs and stuff like that, I find it really tight in the fact that you're able to do this and you're able to find that, like, that little community where people also have similar interests. And it's that little space for like everyone can be themselves, like regarding poetry, what you just mentioned. It's even like little rocks, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it's so cool to me, and like just like that in general, you know what I mean?
Yeah. No, absolutely. And I think didn't like the LA Poet Society also have a reading open mic there, I think. Big shout out to Jessica. I think I saw that once, you know,
for Dia de los Muertos. It was really beautiful. And then one of my favorite bands, Native Sage Against the Machine. Sage Against the Machine.
Okay, that sounds like they gotta come over here then.
I will let them know.
Absolutely.
Yeah, they came through and they played, and not only that, they brought 100 sage plants for the community.
Wow.
So hummingbird sage, black sage, and white sage.
Nice.
Because that's what we're about. We just like sharing greens.
That's so cool.
Shout out to Snoop Dogg.
Hey, here we are. I didn't mean it like that. All right.
God, I'm just getting inspired here. You know what I mean? No, just like, actually, let's get into some inspirational stuff here too. We're gonna go ahead and DJ Carlos over here. Noemi, of course, brought a little playlist. We're gonna go ahead and play that and come back to talk a little bit more about the wash, and then also some visions that Noemi has for us for Panorama City and other parts here of the valley. But what's on deck, Carlos? Tell us.
We got Who Man by Green Tea Peng.
Peng.
You go.
All right, we'll be right back here on Valley Views, y'all.
Searching for balance, praying for clarity. Why strip me naked? Take this identity. Tell me it's unity. In Lakesha, Lakin, I am yo, I'm in. Searching for balance, praying for clarity. Why strip me naked? Take this identity. Tell me it's unity. In Lakesha, Lakin, I am yo, I'm in. I wear clothes I like to hide, so no one knows what I'm made from. Deep in my soul, taken from home, so far we stroll. Deep in these roads, think we control this. We don't, but we could. I'll
wish we would throw away these phones, get a bit more holy, see the world more slowly, take time, smell roses. Searching for balance, praying for clarity. Why strip me naked? Take this identity, tell me it's unity. In the Kesha, Lekin, I am you, you are me. Searching for balance, praying for clarity. Why strip me naked? Take this identity, tell me it's unity. In the Kesha, Lekin, I am you, you are me. See, all I know is that I know nothing a TARDIS is so mystical, magical. And no, we don't know our potential. How could we? When they lie, they cast spells and they thrive, dropping bombs from the skies like we are not stars. Inside me, there's a war. Strip me naked, take this identity, tell me it's unity. In the Kesha, Lekin, I am you, you are me. Searching for balance, praying for clarity. My strip me naked, take this identity, tell me it's unity. In the Kesha, Lekin, I am you, you are me.
Running. I've been searching for the love when I've I've been looking for the dove, and they told me if I move, they gon' shoot me dead. But I think I'm about to go to run. I've been waiting on the summer, so looking back and wondering how we pulled to get from under. They told me put my hands up behind me.
Yes, and we are back, folks. This is once again Valley Views here on KROJ, everybody. My name is Hector, your host, right here with me. Being my co-pilot, co-host, you know, the whole works, is Carlos in the mix. And Carlos, who did we just finish listening to?
We just listened to, I didn't mean to cut you off, I'm so sorry.
No, go ahead.
We just listened to Freestyle by Dinner Party featuring Felix, is that?
No.
I'm so sorry. I was like, did I get that wrong?
This is his first time DJing, so now he knows.
That's my first time looking at these names.
Yeah. Hey, well, that's part of DJing. You gotta get into it like that.
You're right. My bad.
I think that spelling is a little different. That's probably why, too.
Yeah, you know,
I think it's N-I-X at the end?
Yeah, it's P-H-O-E-L-I-X. Yeah. I was like, I think that's Felix.
Yeah, well, artists have, you know, they're creative like that, too.
True. But and it's like such a huge collaboration, too, that whole EP. So that's the other thing, too.
And I love those, like, the little piano and then the horns at the end. That was awesome. Beautiful, beautiful. But we are here, everybody, with Noemi Romo, everybody. And one of the things that I really wanted to really talk about, too, was some of the things happening down by the Sepulveda Rec Center, the Wash, and some of your experiences that you've had there walking that area, and like kind of more like the vision too, mm-hmm. because of those experiences that you've had there. First of all, like describe it to us, like that this particular area of is it Panorama City still right there in that area, or would that be considered?
It's the border of Panorama City and North Hills.
Okay,
it's,
so in that border.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Wash is exactly the border. So just to set the scene, you are on Chase Bridge, which is between Roscoe and Parthenia.
Okay.
And if you look north or south, you're going to kind of see a V that's made out of concrete. And at the base of that V is just soil and water and a bunch of plants. And if you're facing north, you also see the one end of the Sepulveda Recreation Center. If you go through the hole in the fence and you walk at the top of that concrete V, eventually you get to Parthenia, and if you cross the street, boom, you're at Sepulveda Recreation.
Got you. Hey, key right there. Go through the hole in the fence, though. All
right? Go through the hole in the fence.
Yes.
Don't jump the fence. There's a hole there.
There's a hole.
Sometimes the lock is also like already broken. You just gotta wing it. But yeah, pretty much just to set the scene of how I began to get obsessed with this space is that, again, 2020, midst of the pandemic, just moved back home, and I am just absolutely starved for nature. Mm-hmm. And you know, I go outside, I have my binoculars, and I'm seeing like hummingbirds, and I suddenly am seeing this like dragonfly that I've never seen before in my life. And I just kind of follow it, and it goes inside of the Wash, and I'm like, well, heck, like, what's down there? So I go to the bridge, and, you know, I'm suddenly seeing, like, there's thousands of dragonflies. Mm. And I'm just like, whoa, there's a lot of dragonflies here. And then suddenly I see ducks, and I'm like, whoa.
There's a whole environment here.
I'm like, yeah, exactly. It's a whole environment. And all of a sudden I hear this, like, really loud, like, rawr! And I'm like, what is that? Oh, it's a red-tailed hawk. And I'm like, oh, wow. Okay, nice. This is a whole ecosystem. And I already, you know, at nighttime, you hear this, like, whole chorus of frogs and toads. So you kind of know that there's things living in there. But true. When you're walking along Parthenia or Roscoe or even Chase, yeah. you don't really know unless you stop.
True.
Right, right.
And that's because of the way that the legal walkways are set up. Mm-hmm. The legal walkways make it so that you don't really...
notice that.
Yeah, it does exactly. It doesn't create a great opportunity for you to notice,
and or like even access to it. Really, I exactly. mean, because even the way you describe like trying to get there, you know,
yeah exactly.
hole through a fence and everything, man.
Yeah, exactly. yep.
So eventually, going back to Black Thumb Farm, actually, when Lexi had just launched and was like on the GoFundMe, like, hey, help me get this started. Mm-hmm. You know, again, pandemic. I'm unemployed. I'm not doing anything. I'm like, oh, you know what? I'm gonna help fundraise. So I took out my binoculars and just told people on my Instagram, like, hey, like, I'm going to raise some money.
Come join us.
Yeah. Like, if you want to see a frog, $5 to $50. If you want to see a bird, nice. Whatever you want to see, you yeah. tell me. And like, I'll, you know,
mm-hmm. just
send the receipt. Yeah. So myself and like my friends, we ended up raising like between $200 and $300 oh, for wow. them. And it was just through that. And what actually got me to finally go through the hole in the fence was yeah. that one friend really wanted to see a frog. And I'm like, I hear them, but they're oh, down there.
Yeah.
They're down there. So you know what? I finally was like, you know what? I'm going to do it. I have a
wire cutters.
So yeah, so I go through the hole in the fence. I make my way down and I'm seeing hundreds of these tiny little toads or aww. Frogs. Like I can't tell at that age, but I'm just like, oh my goodness, they're so cute. So I'm filming them. And then from there, I kept going there regularly, you know?
Yeah.
And just to, you know, be real for a second, there was also a homeless encampment right next to this space, right underneath Parthenia. There's a homeless encampment. And I just want to be clear that, like, it's not just people who are using. It's also immigrants. Like, it's our people who got screwed over by the pandemic as well.
Not,
you know, we want to villainize these folks. And it's like, you can only do that to a certain extent without, like, factoring in all of the socioeconomic racism and, like, things that our community faces. Yeah. You know, like, the heavy policing. Like, I've seen people that I went to high school with and middle school with in there, you know?
Yeah.
So throughout that whole process of just existing in that space, I got to know them, the homeless folks. I got to know the biota and fauna in the wash, which is just a fancy way of saying the ecosystem.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly I started seeing like a bunch of other people just recreating there. I saw a man on a motorcycle with his little 5-year-old daughter or niece, who knows. Uh-huh. Just at a cool 5 miles per hour, just like going up and down the wash. And there's this little toddler behind them with a tricycle, like trying so hard to keep up, but he just couldn't. There was a mom who every morning would walk with her son there because he loved ducks. And like that was all he wanted to do to start off his day. There was like this older Guatemalan man who like would always be like riding his bike up and down at around 6 p.m. And I'm just like, dude, like people are
people like, love this spot.
Like literally vibing right there.
Literally vibing. And like whenever I'd go, people would always be like, oh my God, be careful. And I'm like, you know, I hear you, but you're also not.
You don't know the full story.
You don't know the full story. Exactly. Right. Mm-hmm. You don't know the full story.
It's one thing to see it from the outside. Another thing like to experience it. Obviously, like you said, there's different things going on there. But like, it's like when you don't know, I guess.
You just because it comes from like an outsider's perspective, you know,
exactly.
Then being like, you got to be careful. You got to be this. And you get there and you're like, this is not the same way they described it earlier. This is like a whole like home that everyone has, you know?
Exactly. Exactly. And so, you know, throughout my entire time there, I was just documenting like what species I was seeing. Mm-hmm. I even took some portraits of, I called them the foos of the wash. It was these two dudes always with beer in hand, always saying what's up to me, like, ah, que haces hoy? Like, just always you know, just checking up on me.
You're like a regular there now.
Huh?
Practically. Yep.
Exactly. And again, not just me. I was not the only regular there.
True.
And so anyway, like, you know, my point is I had been documenting for a long time, and then for a total of a year and a half in the wash, just documenting all the creatures. Mm. And then back in October, I want to say, Pacoima Beautiful, they put the word out that they wanted to speak to people about green spaces in the valley with a focus on parks.
And you're like, I know this.
Yeah, I was like, I got you.
Raise my hand over here.
Yeah, I had a lot of people actually send it to me, and I was like,
oh, wow.
Yeah, and that's what really was where I was like, okay, yeah, I need to do this. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I participated as much as I could, you know, how work can get and yada yada, and I had written something in the first little survey that I had completed for them where I just went off about the wash, where I was like, there is a legit ecosystem green space right here, like it's synonymous to the Los Angeles River, like we got to do something with this. It is literally connected to Sepulveda Recreation Center, like which was one of the parks that they wanted. So I, like, submitted it, didn't really, like, think about it. And then, like, I want to say 2 months later, Vianney from Pacoima Beautiful, shout out to Vianney.
Shout out.
she hit me up and was like, hey, like, I'd actually really love to talk to you about this. So, you know, we set up a time and we figured out, like, okay, like, I'm going to make a report about everything that I've seen there and, like, just really emphasize why our community needs this and why we deserve access to it, and submit it to Pacoima Beautiful to take it from there, basically. So now we have that in the works. They just submitted it, I want to say last week.
Right on.
Yeah. And yeah,
big applause for that. Come on. I mean, that's a, because that's recent.
This it's is like, recent. Yeah. It's happening.
It's happening,
and it's just the beginning. I see this being a years long effort, to be honest with you. And that's you, Hector, that's you, Carlos, that's everybody listening to this. That's where we have to be persistent, where we have to push and be like, hey, we want this green space for us. Mm-hmm. We don't want it for, like, you know, if you look in the neighborhood, there's all of a sudden all these luxury apartments.
True.
Like, we don't want it for the people that are trying to gentrify our area.
Yeah.
We want it for us.
The people who lived here for so long.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Why is it that our people have to
suffer?
Yeah. Why do we have to break the law? Why do we have to potentially get $1,000 ticket or 5 to 6 months in jail just to enjoy a green space?
Yeah. That's through fences, happening. Like.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds absurd, but I mean, that's just the lengths that people got to go through, and it's kind of.
And what do you think as far as, like, you know, because obviously for a lot of these things, you know, there's the like what you said earlier, the legal, you know, like roads or sidewalks. But so speaking of that, like, just what do you think legally or, like, politically really, like, has been missing to make this happen? Because, you know, it's been like this for such a long time now.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think has been some of those factors that have just made this not a priority, if you will, for some of our local representatives? You know, as far as, like, city government, because I would think, you know, officials, public representatives would want more green spaces for our communities, but doesn't seem like that political will has been there, because, you know, obviously we've had different representatives out in our community representing us for such a long time, and yet we're still in this place where, you know, it's taking someone like yourself to actually put this plan forward, and with Pacoima Beautiful and others now. But yeah, just what are your thoughts on that?
You know, I think what's been missing is representation that actually cares about the community, beyond just the photo op. And I'm going to go ahead and name names here. Our congressman, Tony Cardenas, he is not somebody, in my humble opinion, that has our best interests in mind for a lot of reasons. You know, when you take a look at who's funding him, it's pretty clear he's a corporate Democrat. I've lived here for most of my life, and I feel like it's only gotten worse, unfortunately. Outside of, like, mutual aid efforts, it's only gotten worse.
That's true.
He has the worst attendance rate in all of Congress, I'm pretty sure. So, like, for those listening who belong to California 29, that's your representative. That's the record he holds. Last I checked, that's the record he holds.
And so
I think it's a matter of electing a new face that actually cares and understands and is willing to fight for the people. Shout out to Angelica Dueñas. She needs signatures. She needs support. And I really, really hope she wins this time around, because we just need new face. We need a new face. We need someone from this community who isn't bought out. And it's as simple as that.
And do you think in general, just on that note, you know, it takes like a person representing us in Congress to kind of make some of these green spaces, I guess, more of a reality, or like, you know what I mean? I'm just curious, like just tying it back into to that vision that you have, you know, set forward now already, you know?
I think it takes, you know, I'm not going to lie. I don't know, like, all of the legal ramifications or anything like that. I don't know the 1-2-3s of it, if you will. What I do know is that when you have somebody in a position of power that actually, like, cares and listens and is actually has, like, a pulse with the community, they listen to that community. So if I'm showing up, if my peers are showing up and being like, hey, we want this green space, they'll figure out a way to make it happen.
True.
When you just go to any other area on the outskirts of the valley, you see those things happen.
Yeah, we definitely see that too, you know, as far as like just in general, again, like brownfields versus like, you know, places like the Northeast San Fernando Valley versus the West Valley. You know, there's been a lot of, I was listening to a big shout out to 818 Heartbreaks. I was listening to one of their podcasts. They're going to be actually on our show, but they were talking about redlining here in the San Fernando Valley. And, you know, like Pacoima and other Northeast San Fernando Valley communities have been, you know, not just housing wise, but also environmental racism that has occurred here at, you know, higher rates than, you know, like you have other green spaces, other communities. And a lot of it's like socioeconomics. And another one is just like systemic racism that like has been historically documented, you know, and we have different places to point to as far as like, you know, like the communities and like the industrial dumpings and things like that and like where they're placed, you know, or even landfills for that matter, you know. But okay. I mean, you know, we hear you on that as well. And so we're kind of wrapping it up here. We're coming to the end, Noemi. Just, you know, we just want to, first of all, just thank you, like, for being here, being in this space, and really, like, being real with us. Like, I mean, end of the day, that's what we love, you know?
Yeah. That's thank you guys want, for having me.
Yeah. And so tell us, just what do you want to leave our listening slash viewer audience with as far as final words? Words of wisdom from Noemi Romo.
Before I do that, I do want to give a shout out to just my family, my sister, my mom, all of them. For supporting me through this like transformation. And what I want to leave the listeners with is I read this paper called Climate Doom and Gloom, Cultivating Hope in the Face of Basically a Dying Planet. The title was something like that. And when I read it, what I left with was like, whoa, dealing with climate change and all of the changes that our planet is going through is a lot like dealing with terminal illness, unfortunately.
Yeah.
So it isn't a matter of like creating this like false vision for the future. It's about, again, being in a meaningful present, doing what you can literally right now to help those around you and those that you can't see, like the monarchs. Plant some narrow leaf milkweed. Hit me up. I got seeds.
Yay, there it is.
But yeah, it's about living in a meaningful present and being in touch with your community. Build your community, know who they are, and uplift each other. And that's literally so it's literally all we can do in these times. And we just gotta go from there.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. We've had here with us everybody, Noemi Romo. And thank you so much for tuning in to Valley Views, y'all. See you next Sunday. Much love and good vibes, y'all. Take care.